essentially it's a metal 3D printer. And what you do is you spread layers of powder one at a time, and then for each layer you shoot geometry, like a certain geometry, with a laser to melt the powder, and then it reforms as a solid metal. And then you just do that, building up each layer to build an entire part. As you can see in this figure right here, significance of these sort of printers is that one of the main things is they can build geometries that are not possible via typical conventional subtractive methods, using an end mill or something like that. So you can see, like, right there, there's a mesh cube, and it's one of the geometries that wouldn't be possible with conventional methods.
Mm-hmm. So is this for, they use it for medical things other than pretty stuff, or?
Yeah, so there's, so as far as who the main industries that are actually looking into using these 3D metal printed parts is aerospace and medical. Those are the two main industries that are interested in it. Medical is very interested in it because you can use super alloys, certain super alloys that have very good corrosion properties and are very light for how much strength that they have. So kind of ideal to use in a body. And these metals or alloys either are very difficult or almost impossible to machine in, like, normal methods. Also, think if you're making a part for a body, put in someone's body, you might want to cause some pretty complex geometry. And then similar thing for aerospace, they want to be able to create complex shapes that are end up being much lighter weight for how much strength that they actually provide. You can also do a lot of fuel savings. I know GE's making a valve out of a valve that you print one part on the metal machine that replaces 8 separate parts that you'd have to you know, go through all the processes for 8 of those normally. So not only does it save them weight, but it could also, because of how efficient, you know, that trade-off is, it could also save them time and money. But at the very least, it's definitely saving weight. And if you're talking about putting this valve on commercial airplanes, there's some crazy number, like every pound saves them some $1 million a year in jet fuel. So it definitely, the aerospace industry is very interested in it. So the only thing is with a metal 3D printer, it's not, it's very difficult to do a continuous time simulation for the overall parts, but it's very discrete, for discrete parts. So one of the most obvious places to do continuous time simulation is in the point at which the laser actually is incident with the metal powder. However, analytical models for this don't really exist. So there only are approximative models, and those are pretty complicated, so I went with the first approximation here. Just saying that there is some constant deflux, which is essentially the laser point on a semi-infinite solid, which is kind of, which would act as the rest of the part below it, or even just imagine a laser on a plate. And this will give you an approximation for the temperature, according to that equation right there at that point. So I implemented that equation in the model, semi-infinite heat sink. And then, so this is a transient-based model. Modelica standard libraries don't have anything for transient conduction, and you couldn't really use other conduction libraries because if you're talking about a laser just hitting one part very quickly, because the laser usually moves pretty fast, somewhere on the scale of half a meter per second, you can't really use steady state heat transfer there. So you need to use transient heat transfer. Oftentimes the laser is like on one, you know, over 1 millimeter, you know, it'll pass it in less than a millisecond or a millisecond. So you definitely need to be looking at a very small time scale, which makes the problem even more difficult. So I made a first approximation using that model right there. And then what I did after that was that I created a script that would run the model for this time in particular 16 times and with different inputs. So basically, some of your basic inputs to the system are the power of a laser and how fast that laser moves across the part. So laser power and scan speed. So I ran a parameter sweep for laser power and scan speed through the model in just one script, and I plotted it for two different metals. So on the right there's cast iron, and on the left you can see cobalt chrome, which is one of those super alloys that I think is used in medical situations. But each red point is the maximum of each of the curves. So they kind of line up in that sort of fashion because of the way that it's modeled, but I made an approximation for the laser of when it actually hits the point. So having it actually approach one point is again would be much more difficult heat transfer. So I just said I took the amount of time it would take for it to pass over one point, and I just said that was a pulse. It's like a one pulse. So if you look back in the model, in the previous page, I have this pulse function here, which just generates one pulse for the length of time that the laser is over that point. Mm-hmm. And that pulse is the amplitude of the laser power. Okay, so, and then in that script, I also have an output, the maximum temperature for each of the parameter sets. And you can see here that I then have this output a mat file, and I made a script or an M file in MATLAB to automatically take, you just have to run it, and it automatically takes that data and makes a 3D plot. Which maybe I'm thinking now that a 2D plot might be more insightful, but you can see the red plane there is the melting temperature of that particular powder. So anything below that won't fully melt the powder, and anything above that will fully melt the powder. So it's not completely obvious to me, or it's not a completely well-defined thing as how exactly that correlates to something like build quality, which is again pretty vague. But this is definitely a good first step if you're looking at characterizing a different materials. You can just run it through this model real quick and get some idea as to what range of powers and speeds wouldn't work. So you can see for cobalt chrome, which is in the bottom left, it reaches a much higher maximum temperature for each of the same parameters. And that's mostly due to the fact that cobalt chrome has a much lower thermal conductivity. So it doesn't conduct the heat away from that point, but the laser hits it nearly as well. So since I spent most of my time trying to figure out what model I was actually trying to use, that's all I have for now. So if we go over to conclusion, now you can kind of get an idea of what I did. I made that first order approximation. I have a script that can do a parameter sweep, which is oftentimes how you actually run tests and experiments for a metal additive machine. It's much more, there's not a whole lot of in-situ controls currently anywhere in metal additive machines, and that's actually probably one of the biggest areas of research because it is so difficult to do, and you oftentimes don't get data that's actually useful. So basically what you do is you just run a bunch of parameters. You just run a parameter sweep once, and then you decide based off of what the results are, what the parameters you should use are, instead of using some sort of active feedback saying, okay, I can tell based on what I'm seeing right now that I need to change laser power in this direction or that direction. That's much more difficult to do. So it kind of matches kind of that idea. It fits with metal additive. The user input's really easy. You just have the input for the one model and the input for the script. And then it automatically generates comparison plots, and you can run a MATLAB code really easily, generate a maximum temperature plot. feedback for me. I'm sure you do.